have Miklos, Gábor Miklos is unfortunately sick. He's some Gábor in his son. And he was sick about Captain Group have crossed one. And he promised to explain what that means, so we better be lucky.
Okay, how should I use the way? Okay, so Miklos is sending his greetings and apologies to everyone for being sick. So this is what I'm going to talk about, joint with Tom Hodgecroft. Okay, so I will explain what cost is, I will explain what Kazhdan groups are, and I will give you the proof. That's the plan for today. So, cost. So, we will have a group gamma, so gamma group, and S some finite generating set. Okay, and the cost of a group is one half of the infimum of the expected degrees of a given point in a given element in the group, where the infimum is taken over probability measures, invariant, so gamma invariant, so mu is a gamma invariant probability measure on connected spanning graphs on gamma. Okay. Sorry? No Cayley graph. No. No, so this will be in the next line. For now, there is no finite generating set. Just on gamma, we have a group, and we want to put some connected graph on it that spans all the vertices, and as low average degree as possible. Okay, that's the cost of a group. Okay, you can also do it inside a Cayley graph, so the cost.
Same cost of
Rio, yes. Yes. So this is the infimal cost over all probability measure preserving actions. So you can also look at with respect to the Cayley graph, and then you want to minimize this. So infimum over the same thing, except that you want a spanning subgraph inside the Cayley graph. So subgraphs of Cayley gamma S. Okay, and there's a more general notion, which I am not going to define, but hello. So for any probability measure preserving action of the group, you can look at the so you would ask for measurable graphs on these graphings in this space that span the same that span the orbit equivalence relation given by the group action. If you didn't understand this sentence, don't worry, I'm not going to use it. But anyway, so for some people it's interesting. I can realize what
you
for?
You can realize these one for any action of the group, right?
No. 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 So I'm not proving fixed price one. I'm only proving that there is some. So, right? So this could be larger than this. So really, this is the infimum over all probability measure preserving actions here. And So I don't know if I will have time at the end. If you can also do this construction, so giving spanning graphs on this, in a factor of IID manner, there's a theorem of Miklós Abért and Benji Weiss, saying that the factor of IID things are the hardest in terms of cost. Actually, Gábor Elek was talking about that, mentioned this in his talk. So if you could, could do this in a factor of IID manner, then you would prove fixed price one, but we are proving only this. Okay, and so why? So this thing was introduced by maybe I write here maybe the so by Levitt in 95, but then studied by Gaborio in many papers since 98. Onwards, and really, so okay, I will give you some examples, and then you can understand what this is about. So maybe, okay, maybe that's, I'm not sure. Maybe let's write here. Example one, and you know, maybe from the examples you will see why this is an interesting notion. So the cost of amenable groups are always one. So this follows from Ornstein-Weiss theory, Ornstein-Weiss theorem from 1980, saying that all you know, all actions of all amenable groups are the same in terms of orbit equivalence. So you cannot really see, you know, from this orbit equivalence point of view, whatever it is. If you don't know, don't worry. All amenable groups are the same. And so and this cost is an orbit equivalence invariant. So in particular, the cost is the same for all amenable groups. So it follows from this Ornstein-Weiss theory. There's a very simple proof in Benjamin Elias-Peretz-Schramm 99, which I can tell you very briefly. You take a Fellner sequence Fn that the size grows to infinity fast, and you take a random translates of this Fellner set. So for each gamma in the group, you take the translate gamma fn. Okay, so you take this only with probability 1 over the size of fn, and with otherwise you just don't take it. And if you took it, then you close all the boundary edges along the Fellner set, I mean of the Fellner set, of the translated Fellner set. So on your group, you have these translates sometimes, I mean, with this density, and you close the boundaries. Now, the probability that a given gamma will be closed off from infinity is 1 minus this to the power this. Anyway, it's constant. You can believe that, right? It's about 1 over e. So I'm repeating this for all n. This construction, and what I get is that so if this is fast enough, then the density of edges that I closed off is still small. So I'm doing two things. So density of closed edges is closed edges is less than epsilon. So if this fn goes very fast, I can I can make this epsilon as small as possible, I mean, as I want. So density of closed edges is small. But every point is closed off from infinity with probability 1. Okay? So all components, all remaining, well, all components are finite. Okay. right? So I do this on every scale, and eventually I have cut my my group into finite pieces, my Cayley graph into finite pieces, using this small epsilon. And then in each finite piece, I just take a uniform spanning tree that in a, on a finite graph, a tree has average degree less than 2. So here we have these tools. We add these epsilon, this epsilon density back. So we have produced a connected graph with average degree less than 2 plus epsilon. So in this 1 half, we get cost 1. I mean, the infimum cost. Okay, yes, that's another, yes. Okay, so cost is 1 for these things. Now, example 2.
This does not give you the fixed cost, the fixed price.
You can also do this in a factor of IID manner. You can do a version of this and you get a fixed price one. Okay, example 2. So that was the interest of Gaborio, that the cost of the free group on D generators is D. So really, as opposed to the amenable world, where really all actions are the same in some from some point of view, for free groups, they are really different. Cost differentiates between different free groups. So I'm not going to prove this, but so this is Gaborio. I'm not exactly sure, maybe 98. Maybe it's in the first paper. Okay, but before you start thinking that maybe it's something about amenability, this cost equals 1, it's not about amenability. So if you take any group gamma, and direct product it with Z, the cost will be 1. Okay, just because. So you have the Z copies, you have the gamma copies. Okay, and the percolation will be that you take all the edges in Z, in the Z copies, and you take a Bernoulli epsilon bond percolation on gamma, and if you take any two vertices in the direct product, then well, in gamma there is some finite path between them, and on one of the copies this finite path will be open, maybe here, and then you can come here, there. So you get a connected spanning graph with average degree 2 plus epsilon. Or maybe 2 plus degree times epsilon. Huh? Any, actually, the direct product of any two infinite groups has cost 1. Okay, and so this type of idea can be used not only in direct product, but also in, so for instance, in SL3Z. So you have a set of commuting. So if you have a set of generators for SL3Z that if you connect two group elements, if they commute, you get a connected graph, and that's enough to run an argument very similar to this. So go around places and get cost equals 1. And really, these are the two probably the two only main ideas to get cost equals 1. This the hyperfiniteness, so cutting in, the graph into finite pieces with removing small stuff, and this product type structure. okay, what do I want? Yeah, okay. okay, but So this is an interesting notion, but it's not completely clear a lot of times how to compute this cost. So one idea of Gaborio was, so he proved in I think 02 that the cost of a group is always at least 1 plus okay, this is the first L2 Betti number of the group. So that's some L2 cohomology theory that I'm, of course, I'm not going to define. Two probabilistic definitions of this. So one is that beta 1, 2 is the von Neumann dimension of harmonic functions with finite Dirichlet energy. Functions of finite Dirichlet energy. So that's, well, that's an infinite dimensional space. You have to somehow measure dimension in relationship with the, I mean, compared to the degrees or something. And, you know, you sort of factor out by invariance. And this is von Neumann dimension. Anyway, the point is that this is zero if and only if there are no harmonic no non-constant harmonic Dirichlet functions. Okay, and another definition is that the expected degree of the free uniform spanning forest. Okay, this depends on the Cayley graph that you take, but in fact the expected degree doesn't depend on the Cayley graph that you take. It's 2 plus 2 beta 1. Okay, so these are two probabilistic definitions. I'm not going to use either of them, so this was just a cultural remark. Okay, but read the... Okay, so he... I think he conjectured, but I'm not sure. He asked whether this is always an equality. Okay, and so one example where we know this and didn't know this until 3 weeks ago, I guess, something like that, is there's a theorem of Becca and Valette, 97, that beta 1, 2 of Kazhdan groups is always 0. So if you have equality, then the cost should be 1. So in particular, Gaborio asked already in 2002 that, you know, is the cost of Kazhdan groups 1? Okay, I haven't defined what Kazhdan groups are, so that will be the next. So is cost clear? Okay, good. Because you want to, I don't know who asked it, but you want to generate the orbit equivalence relation with as few, you know, as small of a cost, you know, like edges are costly, and you want to minimize that. Ah, that's not known. So in all examples, you can also realize the cost inside the Cayley graph, but it's completely open whether that's always the case. So for amenable, yes, you know what the proof I gave realizes the cost inside the Cayley graph. Our proof will also realize the cost inside any Cayley graph, but in general, don't know.
And you also don't know gamma s over all s. Even this, it's not known.
should have. Ah, okay. Maybe I should remark on that. Oof. So one, maybe you know, from this you should. Oh, did I erase? No. Okay. So from this you can see that one way to prove this thing would be that if there is an invariant way of adding an epsilon density invariant percolation to the free uniform spanning forest, then this would be true. Right? If for any epsilon there was a way of doing that. Hmm? Sorry? Oh, sorry. Yes, yes. That makes it connected. Yes, yes. Right? Because then you would have realized the, you know, then you would have a connected graph with the expected, you know, 2 plus this plus epsilon, the expected degree of that, or degree times epsilon. Sorry? The equality would be true then. Yes. Sorry?
One direction from the
other. Yes, and the other direction would be proved by this, if you could do that. It's known that it cannot be. So, for instance, for Kazhdan groups, for example, adding a Bernoulli epsilon doesn't work. You have to be smarter than that. Okay, this is really not property T, but T in parentheses. That's important. This is the name is given. It means that the trivial representation is separated away from all other representations in the Fell topology. Okay, I hope everyone understood. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay,
so one, okay, so a bit more sense to this, what I said, is that, but this is a definition I'm not going to use, so I don't really define it, I just, for as a cultural remark, I tell you. So for every finite generating set, for every generating set, it actually turns out that Kazhdan groups are automatically finitely generated. So for every generating set and every unitary action of the group on a Hilbert space, there is a spectral gap. Okay. So for instance, for finite groups, there is obviously a spectral gap. Finite groups are Kazhdan. Okay, so, okay, don't worry if you don't quite understand this. Probably everyone knows here Jiger's inequality or Alon-Milman. So there's a version of that here as well in this world. It's less obvious, but still it's not very hard. That for every generating set, and every measure-preserving action, probability measure-preserving action of the group, this action is an expander. Okay, what does that mean? If you take any positive probability event in the in your measure space, then there will be some generator element that takes you out of the set such that the you know, when you translate the event, you move at least by, you know, the positive proportion of the mass is moved out of the ergodic free. Okay, I always mean by action, by probability measure preserving action, I always mean ergodic free. Maybe not quite always. Anyway. uh, Okay, and really the definition I will use, which is really equivalent to this, I mean, it's quite obviously equivalent to that one, is, so this is Glasner and Weiss, 97, is that if you take the ergodic so you take ergodic random two colorings of the group. So this is this space, the set of ergodic two colorings, random two colorings. okay, that's inside all invariant two random two colorings. It's closed in the weak star topology. Among all invariant, so okay. So what does that mean? So in particular, you know, a very simple non-ergodic two coloring is that with probability p, I take the full group. And with probability 1 minus p, I don't take anything. So, you know, 1, constant 1 with probability p, constant 0 with probability 1 minus p. That's not an ergodic invariant 1. And if this holds, that means that you cannot approximate this weakly with ergodic measures. So ergodic two colorings don't get locally constant. You cannot approximate the constant one with ergodic ones, unless the probability of being one goes to one or zero, of course. But in a, you know, non-trivial locally constant things, you cannot get in an ergodic way. And that's a characterization. Yeah. So, and this is kind of, if you think about this, kind of this is the same, right? The number of, you know, the density of edges between zero and one has to stay positive. Right, that's being an expander, and that's being that you cannot be locally constant, approximately constant. Okay, so examples. So example zero, finite groups. Example one. Okay, this is non-example, so amenable. Infinite amenable not Kazhdan. Okay, what is the reason for that? Well, I need to produce ergodic two colorings that get locally constant, right, to prove that it's not Kazhdan, that they are not Kazhdan. How do I do that? I take a large Fellner set around each. So first, okay, maybe. So first, I take IID. Bernoulli. 1/2 IID 0 ones for each vertex in the group. Then I take a large Fellner set and I define a sigma of x, a new, so I define a new 0 1 coloring from this in a factor of IID manner as the majority of these spins of these bits in the translated. In the translated Fellner set. Okay, so this will be 0 with probability half, 1 with probability half, and when you and when you go to a neighbor, you know, you move the Fellner set only a little bit. Majority is noise stable, so just you know you are losing, you know, when you are moving a little bit to a neighbor, you are losing this bit, these bits. You are gaining these bits, but altogether, it's very unlikely that you have changed the outcome of majority.
So symmetry 1/2 is very important.
It's not that important. Well, I mean, if you take the majority with not what half, with not 1/2, then it won't, you won't get something balanced at all. But the 1/2 is not, you know, if you take p here and you are asking, are you above density p? That's also good. So the symmetry, the 1/2 is not important. Okay, well, these examples. So amenables are not. Okay, before you start thinking that it's about amenability, it is not about amenability. Okay, maybe I write it here. Example two, the free group is not Kazhdan. Okay, why? Because if you take the free group generated by two elements and you just project it to Z, generated by the first generator, simply removing all words with B. Not removing all words, but from every word removing all letters that are B or B inverse. So this is a homomorphism, and on Z you can take this coloring, and with this you just pull it up on the free group, and this will be locally constant, right? Because if you are moving with a generator B or B minus, then you actually get the same color always, and if you are moving in the A direction, it's locally constant because of this coloring. It was like that. Okay, so if you have a non-Kazhdan quotient, then you cannot be Kazhdan. Infinite one, an infinite non-Kazhdan. Yes? Yes, you have to prove that that's ergodic, but it's true. And example three. SL3Z is Kazhdan. Okay, and now the theorem is, the title, you know, okay, so the cost of Kazhdan groups is one. Okay, so, sorry? Okay, so first, I reduce the problem to something that might be easier to think about. So cost of a group or the Cayley graph is less than 1 plus 1 half of infimum of expected degrees mu is an invariant percolation, so gamma invariant percolation with a unique infinite cluster. Okay. So, in order to prove cost one, it's enough. So, right. So instead of wanting to make the whole graph connected with cost two plus epsilon. So instead of that, it's enough to produce some infinite connected component with arbitrarily low density. Okay, this is what it says. Okay, and the proof. I give you two proofs. Okay, I write the. Okay, I will give you a pedestrian proof as well, but while I'm erasing the board, I can give you the non-pedestrian proof, and if you so add a wired uniform spanning forest. Okay, if you don't know, don't worry. Wired uniform spanning forest. Wired. So it's the limit of uniform spanning trees along a wired sequence. So you take an exhaustion, and all the edges that go out, you connect them into a single vertex, and you take the uniform spanning tree on these finite graphs, and this is the weak limit of those. The expected degree is 2 of this. It doesn't have to be connected. It's usually not connected at all. But it's certainly, you know, this has an infinite cluster. This is not the pedestrian one. No, this is not the pedestrian one. This is not the pedestrian one. This is the reduction for is for everything. The reduction is for everything. Right. Yes. So in a Kazhdan group, we'll produce an invariant percolation with arbitrarily small density with an infinite cluster, the unique infinite cluster. Okay, so why does it get connected when you add this? Of course, some trees, you know, it's a spanning forest, so some trees certainly intersect the infinite, this infinite connected thing. And then you use this theorem of Tom and Asaf, somewhere, Asaf Nachmias, saying that the trees in the wired uniform spanning forest are indistinguishable. So if one tree intersects this thing, then every tree intersects this thing. So altogether, you get a connected thing. Okay? So this was definitely not a pedestrian proof. Proof two.
Maybe I missed some stuff, but can't you just use Wilson's algorithm to hit the same path? I mean, if you start a random map, you hit the.
Okay, you want to hit this thing with the loop erasure of the random walk. So although it's true that any invariant set is hit by the random walk almost surely, you want to hit it with the loop erasure, and that's not that clear. Okay, for non-amenable groups you can, but okay, this is, yes. So, in you know, we are interested in non-amenable, where the loop erased random walk is not that different from the random walk itself. Okay, so here is the infinite cluster. Okay, so right, the invariant percolation that we have here might have, besides the unique infinite cluster, it might have some finite clusters. Let's just ignore them. Let's just remove them. So here is the infinite cluster. And then I just define kind of a what is this called in a not a vibration. There is some lamination of the graph. So we are doing this inside a Cayley graph, and so eta I is the set of vertices that are a distance exactly I from eta. Okay, so this is eta I. So this is eta 1, this is eta 2, and so on. Now, okay, so every vertex in eta I is in eta I because it is connected to something in eta I minus 1. Right? Okay, so this is in... So eta no is so eta is the infinite cluster. Okay, this thing, this line is the infinite cluster, and eta 1 is the set of vertices at distance 1 from this infinite cluster. Eta 2 is the set of vertices at distance 1 from eta 1. Okay, so in eta I there are edges, finitely many edges going to, because it's a Cayley graph, finitely generated Cayley graph. There are finitely many edges going to eta e minus I minus 1. So pick one of them uniformly at random, and for now orient them to from eta I to eta I minus 1. Okay, now everything has a finite distance from eta. So if you forget about the orientations, this is connected. And if you don't forget about the orientations, the out degree is 0 or 1, depending where you are. Hence, by mass transport principle, the average in degree is at most 1. So altogether, the out degree and in degree together is at most 2. So this is 2 plus small, 2 plus this. Okay, so now in a Kazhdan group, we want to construct a small density connected thing. So construction. Okay, so it will be an.
Before you go to this, do you know whether this is tight or maybe there's equality?
Probably. So for cost equals 1, yes. General. We haven't thought about it carefully. There was an email in which he said no. I don't think he made a good argument for it.
But you can forward this email.
No, there was no argument in the email. So. Okay, so the construction, to get that thing, so it will be an iterative construction. So the first measure that we have, mu 1, is just Bernoulli P. Okay, so from now on, I will want to use the Glasner-Weiss characterization. So I will, I will do site percolations from now on, but if I produce a site percolation with small, with an infinite cluster, with a unique infinite cluster with small density, then I just put the edges inside, the spanned graph, and that still has small degree, so that's okay. So mu one is Bernoulli P site percolation. Okay, and if I already have mu I, then mu I plus 1. Okay, we are doing three things. So take, okay. So first take two independent copies of mu I. So the product measure, so two independent copies. Now take a Q, which will depend on P. Okay, I will tell you in a second how. For each infinite cluster of in mu I, I flip a coin, I keep it with probability q, and delete it completely with probability 1 minus q. So actually the, what just Yuval suggested for the tree. So q thin, okay, this will be called q thinning. So q thin infinite.
Both.
So
it's discrete times.
The iteration? Yes. Okay, yeah. So keep each infinite cluster. Ah, yes, sorry. Sorry. Keep each cluster. Thank you. Good that at least one person, the co-author, is following this. So keep each cluster with probability Q and delete with probability 1 minus Q. So this is what we call Q thinning. So in each copies independently, and then take the union. Okay, this notation is not quite okay, what about this? Well, I don't know. Independent union. Okay. Okay, so just take the union of these two percolations. Okay, that's mu I plus 1. Okay, so what is happening? So with the Q thinning, we have fewer clusters now. And we have, but you know, putting them together, they will intersect, right? So they are kind of getting thicker. So we have, you know, you may hope that with this we are getting fewer but fatter clusters in general. And so how do you actually, you know, that's the intuition. Now, it's quite clear that you can choose Q in such a way that the one-point marginal, so the density of mu I plus 1 remains P. Okay, right? So if by thinning, the density goes down. By taking the union, the density goes up. So of course, you can tune Q such that the density remains constant in along the steps. Okay, and this is an obvious calculation that you can do. What is Q? To do that. I think this. Yes. Okay, so lemma is, so first of all, so the density of mu I remains P. So this is the choice. And then there's another small calculation that to calculate what is the probability that two neighbors are both in together. So mu I of omega u equals 1 is p for every I. So the one-point marginals are constant. And the mu I of what is the probability that for any two neighbors that they are both in, it's of course less than, but in the construction it goes up. Okay, and the way, anyway, it's easy to prove that it goes up to P. That's the only place where it can go to. Okay. So that's a small calculation. Let me not do it due to time.
I'm getting lost. So it goes to P when I goes to P.
Yes. Okay. So really this is getting locally constant at density P. Okay, right? So mu I converges in distribution to P times everything plus 1 minus P. Times nothing. Okay. Okay. So we are approaching what we shouldn't be approaching in a Kazhdan group. But you know, there's a question of ergodicity. Are these mu I's ergodic? So claim is that, how do I want to do this? So on Kazhdan, okay, you can do this on any graph, of course. But on Kazhdan, there is a finite I, IU, such that mu IU has a unique infinite cluster. Okay, right. This is the goal that I have, right? If I can prove this, you know, this has density p. I can do this for any p. So I will. I produced this thing that the reduction asked me to do. Okay. And the proof is that if mu. Yeah, so this. Okay, so if mu I does not have a unique infinite cluster, then mu I plus 1 is ergodic. Okay, I have to prove this. I have to prove this. But if this is true, then we can repeat this. And because, you know, it stays always ergodic, we are in a Kazhdan group, so we cannot approach this. So eventually, this iteration must stop. Right? And in that point, we are done. Okay? So this is what I really have to prove. Okay, and why is that? Okay, how much time do I have? 3 minutes. So, So I want to prove this. If mu I doesn't have a unique infinite cluster, then the next one is still ergodic. It's enough because then, you know, we are repeating this. So if there is no such I where you get a unique infinite cluster, then you can repeat this to infinity. You are always getting ergodic measures, but they are converging to this. In a Kazhdan group, that's not possible. Okay, so, you know, the one sentence lie is that a lot of times it is true that if you have infinitely many infinite clusters and you make some independent finite coloring to that thing, so for instance, Q's in them, what you get will remain ergodic. Okay, there's a theorem in Lyons-Schramm that if mu I has, so Lyons-Schramm 99, indistinguishability of percolation clusters, if mu I has insertion tolerance and infinitely many infinite clusters, then the Q thing, this colored thing, okay, not this thing, the colored thing is is ergodic. Okay. okay. To just apply that theorem, you have to prove that mu I is insertion tolerant. It's not completely obvious because if you want to put in a vertex, if it had something next to it that got deleted. Now that you have put the vertex in, somehow the whole cluster should have been in instead of getting deleted. So in order to put in a vertex, first you have to delete all the neighbors of the vertex. So first you prove deletion tolerance, which is easier, and then you prove insertion tolerance. So by induction, this remains insertion tolerant. So that's one way of doing that, doing this. And okay. But I'm still not done. There is something going on. So, okay, so due to time, so there's a simpler proof where you don't have to prove insertion tolerance and you don't have to quote the whole Lion's Shram, but due to time, let me not do that. We don't know. So strongly mixing or weakly mixing. Okay, so okay, so the so mu, so by induction, mu I is insertion tolerant hence the Q thinned is ergodic if it does so. Right? So if you have infinitely many infinite clusters, no non-uniqueness. Of course, if you have uniqueness, then this Q-thinned cannot be ergodic, right? Because you see that you have deleted positive density. So of course, at that point, it breaks. But if you have infinitely many infinite clusters, then you are still ergodic. so the Q-thinned is ergodic. But then we are taking two independent copies of two ergodic percolations. Is that always ergodic? No. I have only, okay, maybe some people know better examples. I have just very stupid things like with property 1/2, on z squared, you take the black and white chessboard coloring. With property 1/2, you take this one. With property 1/2, you take the other one. That's ergodic. But it's not totally ergodic, but for the whole group, it is ergodic. And if you take two independent copies of that, with property 1/4, you get the full thing. With property, I don't know, and it will be not ergodic. So there are stupid examples like that. However, what does work is that, you know, the same proof in Lion's Shram proves that not only mu iq is ergodic, but also the two independent copies is ergodic. Now, if a measure, if the two wise independent, if this power is ergodic, that has a name called weakly mixing. And that's equivalent to having, you know, not just the two wise product being ergodic, but any number of things, independent things being ergodic. So I can take four copies, four independent copies, that so that's still ergodic. And then I take a factor of an ergodic process. I take the union here, and I take a union here. Okay, that's mu I plus 1. And that's another copy of mu I plus 1. And this is an independent thing. So this proves that the product of the second power of mu I plus 1 is ergodic. Hence, it is weakly mixing. Hence, the fourth power is also ergodic, and you can go on. And that's the proof. Thank you.
So the two questions on the same thing. Assume the group Kazhdan and Rezdor in bind. There is this theorem of Abert and Niccolo that the action on the profile of completion is equal to 1 plus the gradient. Can you say that the cost of that action
I know, not yet.
And what about now? And property tau? Can you say about property tau?
No.
Also not.
It's so for tau. Well, I don't know. We have tried. I mean, these ergodic things, but in tau you need these periodic colorings. They don't work well together. It's unclear what to do. Yes. So kind of, you know, proving fixed price or you know, all of that specific. Yes. But okay, so maybe one sentence that, you know, just as it is, it really, for factor of IID, it cannot work because for when you want only factor of IID measures, in any non-nominable group, you cannot approach a non-ergodic thing. So if this, you know, if this construction could be done in a factor of IID way just like that, then it would be proving that all non-amenable groups have cost one, which is not true. So just like that, you cannot. For relative property T, Alex, for relative property T, it seems we can do it. Yes.
Even if there is some, so even like Z2 similar problem with SL2Z.
Thank you.